My name is Lucy Cox and I'm a London-based soprano. Like all of us, I'm in lockdown at the moment, but I do have access to my computer and a smartphone, so I thought I would use this opportunity to make a short video about the life of the Venetian composer Antonio Vivaldi and to present a recording of one of his motets for solo soprano. Not long before the lockdown began, I took part in a concert with a group of brilliant musicians called Ensemble Fasarinen. We made a recording of the concert, which included Vivaldi's motet for solo soprano Nulla in mundo park sincera, which is probably the most famous of the motets that he wrote for solo voice. And we'll be presenting this in its entirety at the end of the programme. Recognize the piece that you just heard as being from Vivaldi's Gloria, which is one of the most famous pieces today that he wrote and is beloved by choirs and choral societies all across the country. Although Vivaldi was successful in his own lifetime, his music wasn't performed much after his death, and there are still only a few of his works that are really well known today. The other one, which you might well have heard, is his set of four concertos, which is called The Four Seasons. And each one is based on a sonnet, which Vivaldi might even have written himself, describing that season of the year. Here's a short extract from Spring. Vivaldi was ordained, and he was known as il prete rosso, or the red priest, because of his red hair. In his day, he was probably most famous as a virtuosic violinist, but he composed prolifically, writing around 500 concertos and more than 40 operas. These were in great demand in the city of Venice. Vivaldi was born in the Republic of Venice in 1678 into a musical family. He was baptized on the day he was born by the midwife because they were not sure that the baby would survive. Vivaldi's father was a violin player and he would have taught Vivaldi much of his trade. We know that he was composing by the age of 13 because there is a surviving piece that he wrote, a setting of L'Etate Sum, at that age. At the age of 15, Vivaldi began training to join the priesthood, and he was ordained 10 years later. However, he stopped delivering mass after only 1 year, and we have a surviving letter that he wrote to one of his patrons explaining this. In it, he talks about his chronic shortness of breath, which he had since birth, which may explain the emergency baptism. We believe that today, the symptoms that Vivaldi describes might have been recognized as what we now know to be asthma. At this time in Venice, culture was an extremely important part of life because the city-state's power was starting to fade. It lost many of its strongholds in the ongoing Ottoman-Venetian wars, and it was declining as a centre of international trade as other countries such as Portugal began to gain access to the places that Venice used to have a monopoly on. However, like today, it was a popular destination for tourists and travellers, and the city made money by catering to their demand for entertainment. It had an extended carnival season and provided numerous musical performances. This included those which took place at the Venetian Ospedali. Vivaldi became master of violin at the Ospedale della Pietà in Venice, or La Pietà, when he was just 25 years old. La Pietà was one of four such institutions in Venice, and Italy was famous for these organisations during this time. In Naples, there was a great centre of conservatori, which was for boys, and in Venice you had the ospedali for girls. They took in foundling children, sometimes abandoned, sometimes orphaned, And the ospedale translates as hospital, meaning hospitality rather than in the modern sense, so much as we had the founding hospitals in London at this time. The Venetians were obviously keen to discourage anybody from abandoning their children to the care of the state. And outside La Pietà is a stone with the following inscription in Italian. The Lord God strikes with curses and excommunications those who send or permit to be sent their sons or daughters, if legitimate, as bastards to this hospital of piety, having the means and power to raise such, being obligated to compensation of any damages and expenses incurred for them. Neither may they be absolved if this is not fulfilled, as appears clearly in the bull of our Lord Pope Paul III, dated 12th of November 1548. Vivaldi composed a wealth of music to be performed by the girls at La Pietà, and he was eventually promoted to the position of maestro dei concerti, or musical director there. The orchestra gained international attention under his leadership, and the most talented musicians continued playing with the orchestra after they had come of age. These performances would take place every Sunday at La Pietà and on holidays. The organisation was run by a group of nuns, and they would separate the girls from their audiences with metal grills to shield them from the eyes of the public. In his 1739 letters from Italy, the President de Brosse described the music of the orphans of the Venetian hospitals, saying,
"They are educated and maintained at the expense of the state, and their sole training is to excel in music. Thus, they sing like angels and play the violin, flute, organ, oboe, cello, and bassoon. In fact, there is no instrument so big as to intimidate them. They are cloistered like nuns. They perform without outside help, and at each concert, 40 girls take part. I swear there is nothing prettier in the world than to see a young and charming nun in a white frock with a spray of pomegranate flowers over her ear conduct the orchestra and give the beat with all the exactness imaginable."
Vivaldi had to have his position at La Pietà reviewed every year by vote, and he wasn't consistently reappointed. This might have been due to his extensive travelling. He went all over Europe, often with his father. However, he continued to write music for the ospedale, even when he didn't have an official position there. He also composed and performed for many different patrons, including Emperor Charles VI, the Duke of Lorraine, Prince Philip of Hesse-Darmstadt, and Guido Bentivoglio d'Aragona, who was a marquis from Ferrara, with whom Vivaldi staged many operas at the carnival season in Ferrara in the late 1730s. This is an oil painting by the Czech artist Jan Kopecký of Emperor Charles VI, whom Vivaldi had first met in Trieste in 1728. Charles VI was a valuable patron and had given Vivaldi a gold medal, a knighthood, and an invitation to Vienna. Vivaldi's final trip was to Austria, where he may have been hoping to gain a position at the imperial court in Vienna. Sadly, just after he'd arrived, Emperor Charles VI died, leaving Vivaldi without a patron, and resulting in all of the theatres in Vienna being closed for the entire carnival season. Vivaldi stayed on in Vienna for reasons that seem to be unclear, and it's possible that it was because of his ill health. He died there in 1741 and was buried. His music continued to be performed for the next few decades, especially in France, and then he faded largely into obscurity. The big revival of his work came when Bach's transcriptions of some of his concertos were discovered, and also when his own personal collection of scores was unearthed in the 1920s. To go into more detail specifically about the piece that we're going to be playing for you at the end of this programme. I wanted to give you some historical context, as well as translations of the texts for each movement, and a few things to look out for in the music as you listen. There were sometimes opportunities at the wealthier churches in Venice, including St. Mark's Basilica, for performances of one or more solo motets with religious text to be inserted within a mass. These works would often have been performed by renowned professional soloists, and Vivaldi wrote several motets which could have been used in this context. Nulla in Mundo Park Sincera is one of these. Singing this music, you get a real sense of Vivaldi's training as a string player and the fact that he was used to writing for highly skilled performers. He writes virtuosic lines for the voice, which you can imagine might sit easily under the fingers of a violinist, but require a lot of agility for a singer. There is a real sense of fun and challenge in the music, and plenty of opportunity for the singer to interact with the players. The performers you will hear in our recording of this piece were using instruments similar to the ones which Vivaldi might have been familiar with. They're strung with gut rather than with modern materials, as you would hear today, and they use an older style of bow than the ones that we would find in a modern orchestra. We chose to perform the music one per part, with a chamber organ playing continuo alongside the cello. It's impossible to know how many people would have been involved in performances of this piece in Vivaldi's time, but we enjoyed the chamber music feel of having it one per part, and the individual responsibility of this setup. In this performance, I tended to take repetition of the same melodic line in the soprano part as an opportunity to ornament the music, which is a fun approach, although it does add to the challenge of performing the music. It helps the piece to build in tension from the relatively tranquil opening of Nulla in Mundo, the first movement, to the excitement of the Alleluia at the end. The first movement introduces a smooth, lilting melody in compound time, which begins in the violins and is then taken up by the solo singer. The words are, "Nowhere in the world can true peace be found without bitterness. Purity and truth, sweet Jesus, is in you. Between anguish and torment lives the contented soul, spotless love its only hope." This is followed by the second movement, which is a recitative, where the soprano sings the words to a more speech-like rhythm, accompanied by the continuo instruments, in this case the cello and the chamber organ. The meaning of the words is, "With alluring colours, the world deceives the eye, but hidden wounds traverse our hearts. We flee the one that laughs, the one that follows us, for by showing us his delights, he could overcome us." On the word Fujiyamas, which means to flee, you can listen out for a lovely example of word painting, where Vivaldi makes the soprano line run away through the use of a series of quick semiquavers. The third movement is the most florid yet and goes into the most detail in its text about temptation. It begins with an opening series of semiquaver runs to the word spirat, which represent the hissing of the serpent. And these passages are repeated several times throughout the movement. Each time I decorate them slightly differently. Towards the end of the movement, you will hear the orchestra drop away while I sing a final flourish in the form of a little bit of improvised music called a cadenza. The words translate as, "The hissing serpent uncoils among the flowers and the colours, hiding its venom. But secretly touched by lips, a person mad with love often kisses like licking honey." The motet ends with a joyful Alleluia, in which the soprano and the first violin have a series of paired semiquaver passages in thirds, and the piece closes with a final one that goes all the way up to a top C. This is the most virtuosic movement of the piece yet. The players of Ensemble Fasarinen that you're going to hear on this recording are Kate Conway on the cello, Jeffrey Irwin on the viola, Claudia Nortz and Emma Lake on the violin, Oliver John Riven on the chamber organ, and me, Lucinda Cox, singing soprano. The recording was made by Chris Hartland, and the performance took place at St Thomas's Church in Groomsbridge. Edmund Saddington acted as cameraman, editor, and voiceover artist. I would like to thank Angel Early Music for their support in making this video. I hope you enjoy the performance. Thank you. Oh.